The system life cycle is something that starts to become more widely acknowledged as computer systems start to become more popular. Most people didn't need to think of things like farming as a system. It was just something that farmers did. But with more and more things being automated, so too did more and more things start to be considered as systems. Naturally, because automating process became a possibility, people started to do it, and they documented how they did it so that they can repeat the process. They would first learn about the process and document all of the requirements of the system. When that was complete, and only when that was complete, they would sit down and design the system, drawing sketches of every user interface, detailing how every piece actually connected together. When they had completed that phase, and again, only when they had completed that phase, they would hand everything over to the software developers who would code the entire project. When the developers had finished writing their code, and yet again, only when they had finished writing the code, they would invite the original people back to verify that they had done everything according to the specifications they had been provided. Assuming that they had finished, the software would then go live. There would also be a short maintenance period after the product was launched where any critical fixes would be put in place, but no new functionality would be developed during that time. This methodology was called waterfall because there is no going back. If there is a mistake in the requirement stage, it's almost impossible to go back and change things later on, which means that everything had to be perfect. It's also called waterfall because of the tool used to manage the systems using this methodology, the Gantt chart, which resembles a waterfall a little. People started to use this methodology in the real world, and because humans aren't perfect, they did make mistakes in the requirement stage, which did cause problems throughout the rest of the project. People needed to be able to account for mistakes so that they could release better products. Another problem with waterfall is that it assumes that nothing will change in the system while it's being developed. But again, in the real world, there are changes to systems all the time. And so in the time it took for the requirements phase to launch, the system being automated has already moved on. Finally, there was the problem that arises when you're looking at bigger, more complex systems. Because there were such huge amounts of information for people to explain to software developers, it was very easy for them to make mistakes, and it was almost a requirement that software developers be experts in how the entire system worked, and how every single piece interacted with every other individual piece of code, which was just impractical. People have started to eventually realise that following waterfall methodology to the letter isn't the best way to do things. Many people in the sector have instead moved to what's called the Agile methodology instead. Agile is both similar to waterfall and very different at the same time. Almost the same phases take place, but instead of waiting for one stage to end before the next begins, Agile almost does all of the stages at once, but it does those stages many times over much smaller periods of time, so if there is a mistake, there are plenty of opportunities to spot it and correct it, compared to only one opportunity with the waterfall methodology. A typical project managed in an agile environment will involve the gathering of requirements, which is called the product backlog. The person who's created the product backlog, also known as the product owner, will then typically sit down with the development team and give them an overview of what the overall aim of the project is, but without going into too low-level detail about each specific step in the process. Together, they break down the product backlog into smaller chunks called user stories, before the product owner outlines the specific tasks that they want the team to complete in the forthcoming block of time or sprint, with each sprint normally lasting about 2 weeks. The development team will then break the assigned user stories down again into further individual tasks, and each person on the development team will take and complete tasks from the agreed tasks for that sprint each day. It's normally the case that only one task can be allocated to each person at any one time, so that it will never be the case that the entire project is delayed because people are waiting on one person to complete a task that won't be completed for several hours. At the end of each sprint, The product is presented to the product owner in its current state for review, and if any adjustments need to be made, they can ask for them to be made as part of the next sprint. This process repeats until the project is complete. Agile's not without its problems though. Because it's primarily branded as a software development methodology, people are reluctant to use it for other types of systems development. The fact that there are many sprints means that it can make managing progress closely problematic, because the development isn't at any one specific point in a time, it's in a specific area, and being more relaxed about management, particularly of big expensive projects, can be a huge attitude shift. It also requires that a relationship be established between the business and the people who are doing the development. There needs to be a two-way communication. This sounds obvious, but it's not always the case with waterfall-based projects. You could potentially give the developers everything they need and not see them again until the project is completed. A final criticism of Agile is that it often results in little or no documentation for the project. No user guides, no support documents. This may not be a problem for someone who is developing on their own, but if the development is for a big company, where people change jobs frequently, this can become an issue. As we've discussed, there are problems with both approaches, but in my experience, it's usually easier to solve the problems resulting from agile development than it is to resolve the problems resulting from waterfall-based project development. If you're a systems analyst, chances are that you will encounter both methodologies, or variations of them, used in many different companies. If you're looking at this series to help you with a project you're working on as part of your main role, I would suggest trying to use the Agile methodology if possible. It's by far the most forgiving to use, and it's definitely the more modern approach because Agile has learned from the mistakes of Waterfall. The reason you should know multiple methodologies if you're doing systems analysis professionally is that these two are both extremely common. And so knowing them both will allow you to talk to your client using the language that they are most likely to understand. Systems analysis is complex enough without trying to teach your clients new approaches, as well as all of the work involved with actually analysing their systems.